Hi, this is Roger Marsh for Dr. James Dobson's Family Talk. Excited to share that this entire week of programs will be centered around the importance of romance and marriage. Each day this week on the program, we'll have broadcasts dedicated to empowering you and your spouse to fight for your marriage. Head over to our website at drjamesdobson.org to join us for our free 10 Days of Romance series. And every day for 10 days, you'll receive insights on intimacy from Dr. James Dobson and best-selling author Shanti Feldhahn. Again, you can join in at drjamesdobson.org.
Today on Family Talk.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to Family Talk. I'm your host, Dr. James Dobson, and we're going to talk about marriage today. The Creator says in Genesis 2 that men and women were designed specifically for one another, and when they come together under the banner of marriage, they become one flesh or one identity. Now, I've paraphrased that, but you know that scripture. And what an incredible concept it is. In other places in Scripture, we read that this commitment is intended for life and that husbands and wives are to love each other and care for each other unconditionally. Jesus himself echoed this scripture. In fact, he was quoting from Genesis 1:27 and 2:24. And he said, and this is in Matthew 19:3-6, "Some Pharisees came to him to test him, and they asked, 'Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife for any kind of reason?' 'Haven't you read,' Jesus replied, 'that at the beginning the Creator made them male and female, and said, for this reason,'" and by the way, this is Genesis 2:24, "'for this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh.'" So they're no longer two, but one. "And therefore, what God has joined together, let no man separate." Now, recently, we sent Dr. Tim Clinton on a mission. He's got plenty to do in his own right, but he agreed to do this, and we asked him to interview Dr. Sharon May. She is a licensed marriage, family, and child counselor, state licensed, and she's the daughter of our dear, dear friend Archibald and Kathleen Hart. She's the head of the Safe Haven Relationship Counseling Center in Southern California, and she and Dr. Clinton are going to discuss the terrible downward spiral of brokenness and anger and hurt that some couples find themselves in, how they can break free from that cycle and reconnect with their spouse. It is possible. Now, let's go to part one of this great conversation here on Family Talk.
Today on Family Talk, we have an amazing guest, actually one of my favorite guests, Dr. Sharon May. She serves clients from the greater San Diego area, Orange County, Los Angeles, and by the way, all over the country, because she is involved now in what's called new marriage intensives. We're going to be talking a lot more about that. But Sharon, hey, it's great to have you in studio. Always fun to be with you.
Oh, it's really good to be with you, Tim. Thank you so much for having me on the program.
Sharon, you're an expert in relationships. We're going to talk today about primarily loveless, empty relationships. I heard someone say once, there's nothing more beautiful in all the world, Sharon, than to be in a relationship with someone who's supposed to love you, and they actually love you. And there's nothing more painful in all the world than to be in a relationship with someone who's supposed to love you, and they don't love you. Sharon, what are you seeing out there in the landscape of relationships, of marriages that you serve every day?
You know, Tim, what you are describing is the heart of God. Because if we go back into the New Testament, or go forward into the New Testament, we hear God's heart in saying, love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your mind and all your soul, and love each other. That it is the heart of God for us to love and be loved. We thrive in life when we are in a healthy relationship in a healthy marriage relationship. And I sit just about every day, all day, with couples, and most of them fighting, of course.
All we do is fight. Everybody fights.
Yeah, in the marriage intensives that I do. And that I see at the heart of a couple's conflict is a longing to be heard, to be seen, to be understood, to feel, are you there for me? Do you care for me? Do you have my back? Do you hear me and understand me? And we get stuck arguing and fighting in attempts to be heard. But our attempts are usually more destructive than they are constructive. And so couples land up having years of that hurt me, do you see me, do you understand me, defending, I'm not as bad as you think I am, I didn't mean that, hear me, understand me, and this battle we get into that leaves both of us hurting, disconnected.
Let's offer our listeners a guilt-free drop here for a moment. Sharon and I are both going to tell you this, that all marriages are going to go through periods of disaffection.
Marriage is hard work.
and it can turn into a mess.
Yes.
It really can be a mess and painful, yes, because it's not fun being in a relationship that's not working and going out on a date night with somebody you don't like.
Yes, and you might be in love. You might love each other. I find that a lot of couples say, I love my spouse, but I don't like them. Because it is the impact or the residue of resentment and hurt. You haven't seen me or heard me or understood me. You know, couples argue. So if you want to know, do I have a healthy marriage? The barometer can't be how often do we argue or we fight or how different we are. Because we usually marry someone who's very different.
Sure we do.
And as John Gottman says, our differences are going to be there 4 years later because our differences are about personality and lifestyle differences. But it's what we do with those differences and how we argue that either fosters that safe haven, fosters that close connected bond, or destroys it. Or starts disintegrating it. So what is a healthy marriage? A healthy marriage really is a couple who is able to turn toward each other because they have three ingredients. Tar. It's the tar, the glue that keeps us together.
Okay.
Is trust. I trust you with my heart. I trust that you have my best interest in mind. So that even though you say something that's maybe rude or your tone of voice or you forget to do something, I know that at the end of the day, I can trust you with me. Secondly, that you're going to be available to me emotionally, that you care enough, you're going to slow down, you're going to be attuned to me, and you'll get to know me. And then thirdly, that you're going to respond in the best interest of us, that you will respond in a considerate manner, and that a healthy marriage is one where, of course, we're going to disagree. We're going to disagree probably about most things, but that we can turn toward each other. That we can say, you know, last night that hurt me, and that we can be influenceable. Did I hurt you? I'm so sorry. You know, but what I was trying to get you to understand was that we can turn toward each other. We can resolve things. And at the end of the day, I know you're going to be there for me. You'll listen to me, understand me, and be influenced by me.
So, Sharon, let's step back for a moment because we know this. You've been there. I've been there. There are moments in a relationship when you don't have the tar factor going.
Yes.
And I've heard this statement, the level of intimacy or closeness, emotional closeness between us, will never rise above the fear or anger between us.
Yes.
So here's this fight, the pace, the pressure, the pain of modern day life's beating us to death.
Yes.
And it's not fun to come home.
Yes.
Sharon, let's start there.
Yes.
Let's go to ground zero for a moment, and let's kind of do a repair. That's what you talk about. You'd like to do relationship repair.
Yes.
Take us basic steps. Where do we go?
Yes. First, we've got to realize that we did marry someone whom we had hoped would be our safe haven. So that on
an expectation there. Yeah.
Yes. And that on our wedding day, we did say, Lord, this human being is imperfect. I am. But I am choosing to be with him for a lifetime. We have to go back and remember there was something about this person that drew my heart to them. And as we hold that hope of, Lord, can we come back to that? We then pull back and say, what has been the ugly cycle that we've gotten stuck in that has caused us to disintegrate. Sometimes it's not that we've married the wrong person. It's that the resentment and the cycle that we get stuck in has kept us guarded and protective and angry and hurt.
Let's talk a little bit about when the pain comes, how, like John Gottman has taught and our friend Scott Stanley and others have taught, these are marital research experts, that negative communication patterns start developing and taking over the relationship. And it isn't really about trying to hurt each other when we start criticizing. The problem is you never show me you love me. It's you. Sharon, you're the problem. You are the problem. No,
yes.
Tim, you're the problem. And this chaotic communication
yes.
pattern, which is really trying to recover the relationship or get you to love me. I'm just trying to get your attention. I want
right.
you to know I'm not happy. I'm frustrated, please. And so what I do is I attack you almost, I criticize you
yes.
and say, you're the problem.
Right.
Which, by the way, puts you on a defensive. Talk about that.
Absolutely.
Communication.
Because that is the negative cycle we get stuck in as we are trying to be heard. So I then up the ante and I pursue you and I say it louder and harsher and more critical, hoping that you will understand that when you didn't take the trash out, it really made me feel hurt. But then as I pursue and I get hot and angry, the more you're going to defend yourself and you're going to say, I'm not as bad as you say I am. You know, these are the reasons why I blame. And we get stuck in this pursue, withdraw, this attack, defend pattern.
Yeah, it's almost
and,
like, hey, it doesn't matter what I do. I can't make you happy. You're impossible. It's not me. What else
yes.
do you expect from me?
Yes.
You heard him saying?
Absolutely. And what Daniel Wiley says that I can't hear you until I feel you understand me. And so I then get on my high horse and I am desperate to get you to hear me. But you can't hear me because you feel I don't understand you. And we get stuck in this cycle. And if couples stay stuck in the cycle where we start rewriting our safe haven, we start rewriting, you know what? You're not safe. You're not a good man. You're not there for me. I can't trust you with my heart. And then you become the enemy. And if I am living with the enemy, I close up my heart. Mm. I take my heart back and I am guarded and I am quick to respond. I'm quick to get angry. I'm quick to be defensive. And then you are as well. And we get two people who have rewritten the safe haven as saying, you're not my safe haven. I need to protect and be guarded. And we then start living parallel lives. I start then trusting my friends. I take care of the children. I maybe do tasks and my hobbies, and so do you. You work more. Maybe you're playing golf. You've got your buddies. And we are then home alone. And as you said at the beginning, Tim, when we're in a marriage where we're supposed to have someone who cares for us, is there for us, and we feel so guarded, like you're not there for me, we feel home alone. And that's the saddest place to be. I can't trust you with me. You don't understand me. All you do is defend. You always blame me that I'm the bad person and I'm home alone. And that sadness and grief often is masked and is covered with anger and resentment. And we lose sight of our softer heart. We lose sight of saying, you know what? I've gotten so angry and resentful and mad at you. And we lose sight of knowing how to say, you know what? Our arguments have gotten where I'm so guarded. I don't even trust you with my heart anymore. But I know I married you because you were special to me.
Yeah.
And you had meaning to me.
And it's confusing.
And now it's confusing.
And it's chaotic.
And it's chaotic. And you know, Tim, couples stay in this chaotic space. John Gottman says for 4 years before they cry out for help. Some couples stay here for 15 years. And then they say, why are we even married? And they divorce when actually they're longing to find a way back home to each other.
Sharon, in some of the research out there on broken couples, we're learning that negative interactions are far more predictive in value than positive ones. So in other words, if all you do is fight, all we're doing is fighting. I mean, every time I pick up the phone, all we do is fight. Every time we see each other, all we do is fight. Every time we go out on date night, all we do is
fight.
Fight. What are they saying there when they say negative behavior is far more predictive than positive behavior? It's like 5 to 20 positives to counteract one negative in a bad marriage.
Right.
That means we got some work to do to get rid of the negative, right?
Yes. And the more we stay stuck arguing, the more I start viewing my spouse as not safe. You don't care about me. You don't have my best interest in mind. And the more I redefine you as the enemy. And if we stay stuck in that rut, you are my enemy, I will approach every event as you are the enemy. You're against me. I won't trust your intentions as being positive. I won't give you the benefit of the doubt. Forgiving of or letting go of small little slights doesn't happen. And we're quick to be irritable, to be critical, and to be harsh. And if you are stuck in that marriage, you have to take a step back. Maybe you've been like a frog in the kettle and you've gotten there and you're listening right now of saying, oh my goodness, this is my marriage. You mean it's not supposed to be this way? Mm. No, it's not the heart of God. The heart of God is for you to love well. The heart of God is for you to grow and become everything He has for you so that you can love well. And you need to take a step back and say, time out. I am not going to continue my part of this negative cycle. I need to take a step back and say, okay, what is the cycle my husband and I are stuck in, or my wife and I are stuck in? Name that cycle. Draw it out on a piece of paper. When I say to my husband, you didn't take the trash out, this is what I'm feeling. This is what he does in reaction. This is what I then do in reaction to him. Draw the cycle and say to yourself, maybe go to your spouse, you know what? I think this is a cycle we get stuck in. I don't want to do it anymore. I don't want to be the angry pursuer who feels like a mother telling you what to do, because then I feel like you're a child. I then feel like you don't have my back. I don't want to have that position anymore. I want to change it.
And the truth is, Sharon, when you get into that pattern, I'm looking at you thinking, I don't like you.
Yes.
You become the exact thing that I don't like.
Yes, exactly.
And what's interesting, too, is when we get in trouble, we default to our strengths. So what that means is if I'm pretty orderly and controlled and I want things solved right now, I'm intensely that way.
Yes.
And if you're free-floating and you like a little space and you want to be playful, you don't like that person. But we then begin to see each other wrong. It's like, I see you as intrusive, manipulative, controlling, demanding. Truth is, all you want is just some type of loving response. But I think it's the opposite.
Yeah.
You see me as, like, withdrawing, uncaring, aloof, distant. Because if you really cared for me, you really loved me, you'd come to me. You'd talk to me. You'd solve these issues. And I'm thinking, no, I won't. Because every time I do, all we do is what?
We just argue and fight. But you know, Tim, what you've outlined is in a very beautiful way, but for many of the listeners, probably it's hitting home for them, saying that's exactly how it is at home.
Yeah.
It's being able to take a step back and identifying it. If your husband is withdrawing and shutting down and defensive, what is really going on at the heart? He's not wanting to have a miserable marriage. He is longing to be heard and understood. And those are his coping mechanisms. Those are his protective coding. And if your wife is always angry and pursuing and attacking, that is more of her defensive mode, her protective mode. That's not at the true heart of what she is trying to get at. The true heart of what she's saying is, can you please put your hand through my porcupine quills, through all of my yelling and my criticism, and know me. Really get to understand what I'm really trying to get you to hear and see. And put your hand through that cold ice wall of your husband and get to his heart of saying, beyond you're shut down and you're no longer talking and distracted, put your hand through that ice cold wall to the heart of him. And until we can, as couples, slow down, recognize our negative cycle, and move towards understanding our own softer side and the softer side of our spouse, we will stay stuck in our negative cycle.
Maybe it's just two broken people who were trying to fix something that's not getting fixed. You're right. We're empty and lost, and we're angry. We're really angry.
Yes. And if you've come to a place where you are too angry and too lost and too empty, and that it feels so big for you to be able to go to your softer side and say to your spouse, to say to your husband, you know what, I've been so angry lately, for years maybe, and I've been resentful, and I've taken back my heart, I don't trust it in your hands anymore. If it's too difficult for you to be vulnerable, to go to your spouse and make that confession, then it is time for you to reach out to get help, to be able to go to your spouse and say, this is too big for us.
I want to talk about that, Sharon, as we wrap up our very first day here, talking about empty, loveless relationships and what you can do. Because we really believe God's in the midst of that. Even no matter where you're at right now,
Amen.
There's still hope. And we want to bring that word to you. But Sharon, for Christians in particular, too, there's a lot of shame and embarrassment when your marriage doesn't work.
Absolutely. And when you realize that that struggle is a human being struggle, we all argue. And arguing is not dangerous to a marriage. It's not being able to come to some resolve, being able to turn toward each other and to be able to come to some, okay, I understand you, but I disagree. All right. And we can turn toward each other and still feel loved and cared for. That is key. When our arguments leave us disconnected and angry and resentful, then our arguments become dangerous. So first, you're a human being. If the two of you have differences, that you don't agree on how the dishes should be packed in the dishwasher, welcome to being a human being. If you argue on the way to church, welcome. I bet you your pastor, more times than not, has argued on the way to church.
Oh, yeah.
But it is then finding a way out of that resentment and getting stuck in the negativity of the cycle, is finding your way out to saying, I still love you, I care for you, I want to grow old with you. Let us remember that we are each other's safe haven. Let's recognize the cycle that we get stuck in. We're not going to have the cycle win or beat us down. There is a way to be able to resolve so we can turn toward and still find a safe haven with each other.
Sharon, a very significant conversation. It influences or impacts all of us. I know in counselor training, we say this. When we train counselors, we tell them, you can't treat what you don't see. You got to be able to see it. To those of you who are out there, you may be a little frustrated saying, wait, what are we going to do? What's next? We're going to come back tomorrow. Sharon, if you'll be gracious enough to do that for us and talk about the journey back toward feeling safe, to being emotionally free. How about emotionally close with each other, where you can trust, where you can accept influence from one another, where you can enjoy your life and love together. You promise you're going to do that?
Absolutely. I look forward to it.
All right. Once again, this is Dr. Tim Clinton, president of the American Association of Christian Counselors, sitting in for Dr. Dobson today. Our special guest has been Dr. Sharon May. Sharon runs the Safe Haven Relationship Center. She's actually out of California. She's fun. I don't know if you've noticed her South African accent, but it's spectacular. Sharon, how can people reach you, want to learn more about what you do, maybe some of the books you've written, and the gift of grace that you are to all of us?
Mm. If you want to reach me, you can reach me at grow@havenofsafety.com. That's grow@havenofsafety.com. And my website is safehavenrelationshipcenter.com, safehavenrelationshipcenter.com. We have information there about how to heal your marriage, the intensives, the marriage intensives and classes that we offer. And if you are a therapist and you are looking to get training in a very effective way of helping couples heal and grow in their marriages, emotionally focused therapy, the faith-based emotionally focused therapy, you can find information there as well.
And by the way, don't forget to take the Healthy Relationship Challenge here on Family Talk. Get up on our website. Feel free to call us. But man, do we want you to join in on this project.
Well, this is James Dobson again, and you're listening to an interview Dr. Tim Clinton conducted with Dr. Sharon May. We requested that they get together, and I think you've been touched today by what they had to share. If you would like to know about Dr. May's Safe Haven Relationship Counseling Center, you can learn more by going to our website, drjamesdobson.org. And there you're going to find Safe Haven's website and all that they offer for the struggling and hurting marriage. And that's what we're all about today. That's drjamesdobson.org. And then click on today's broadcast page. Thanks for listening, everybody. Hope you enjoyed the program. Remember to join us tomorrow to hear the remainder of the conversation between these two clinicians, Dr. Tim Clinton and Dr. Sharon May, as they examine how struggling couples can establish love in their relationships and then move forward in their marriages. That's next time on Family Talk. I'm Dr. James Dobson. Have a great day.
Family Talk is not associated with Focus on the Family.
Thank you.